very much. Thank you very much for the warm welcome. It's really my pleasure to be here talking to you all today. At BNEF, we've had the privilege of working with Macquarie actually for many years on the energy transition, so I'm delighted to be part of the discussion. And I'm going to be just sharing a few thoughts on how we see the energy transition in 2023, really building on some of the comments that Catherine and Shamara have already made, and to make the case that we've entered a new era, actually, in the energy transition. So we start by looking backwards. If you think back to last year, it did actually feel like the end of an era in the energy transition. It was the first time in as long as any of us can remember that the costs of clean energy actually started to rise. With the exception of offshore wind, all of the other main technologies, onshore wind, solar, battery storage, all of those technologies actually got more expensive during the first part of last year, thanks to inflation and supply chain challenges. And at the same time, we saw this country ambition that had been rising so steadily in the run-up to Glasgow in 2021, really over 3 or 4 years up to Glasgow, this incredible rise in net zero commitments started to tail off. And actually, before Glasgow, or in the run-up to Glasgow, we saw that 90% of the world's emissions were covered by some kind of country or state-level net zero target. And that number barely budged throughout 2022, and it's pretty much still the same now. And we also saw fossil fuels make a bit of a comeback. Coal generation actually rebounded in 2021 and 2022 and reached an all-time high, actually, in coal use in the power sector globally. And we saw fossil fuel investment as well, oil and gas and coal investment in upstream supplies also start to rise, and rebounding again from a low that we'd seen a couple of years before. And then finally, you can't talk about 2022 without talking about geopolitical complexity. Not only Russia's war in Ukraine, concerns about China and the situation in Taiwan and supply chain resiliency, but also the tension between Europe and the US over the Inflation Reduction Act, tension across emerging Asia over the impact of the European war and European energy policies on the prices of energy globally, which also impacted countries in Africa. So this complexity really scaled up in 2022 as well. But if we've entered a new era in the energy transition, then one thing that we're not seeing is any kind of slowdown whatsoever in the energy transition. And actually in 2022, we saw for the first time money flows into energy transition technologies exceeded $1 trillion. So $1.1 trillion invested in energy transition deployment last year, a 31% increase, that is, on the year before. And that's money flowing into renewable energy projects. It's money flowing into nuclear, even, refurbishments and new projects, into energy storage, battery projects, hydrogen, carbon capture projects. It's the sales of electric vehicles, it's the deployment of charging infrastructure, it's heat pumps, it's recycling and circular economy, it's clean steel. All of these areas are now a $1 trillion market. And in fact, every one of these subsectors on this chart, with the exception of nuclear, was at a new record level of investment in 2022. So absolutely no sign of a slowdown in this new era. And we know that the supply side is going well, we know that renewables are scaling up, but one of the really interesting themes that we're picking out from the numbers at the moment is electrification is really driving the acceleration. Electrified transport, out of that 1.1 trillion, transport is now 466 billion. It's this close to overtaking renewables in terms of the size of money flows there. And that's thanks to, you know, we now know 10 million electric vehicles were sold globally last year, and it's a 50% increase in terms of that market size. Heat pumps as well, we don't talk enough about electrifying heat. We don't talk enough about buildings. But that market's growing very quickly as well. In fact, residential heat pump installations were worth $64 billion last year, and that number has doubled over the last 5 or 6 years. So we're really seeing not just the supply side, but also the demand side starting to move. And then importantly, some of those less mature technologies, some of those technologies that we know need to get to scale by 2030 are starting to scale. Investment into hydrogen production tripled last year. That's the fastest growing sector. It's still small, still only a billion out of that trillion that we tracked, but moving in the right direction. Carbon capture and storage is now a $6 billion investment opportunity per year, and that roughly tripled as well over the last year. Interestingly, carbon capture is now being deployed and planned across a number of different sectors, across power, across oil and gas and materials and chemicals, and even in direct air capture as well. So we're seeing a variety of different applications now emerging for carbon capture and storage. And finally, you have to take a nod to the Inflation Reduction Act. You know, in 2022, we saw the most important, the most consequential piece of climate legislation that the US has ever passed, possibly the most important policy achievement in the low carbon transition since the Paris Agreement. And we're starting to see the impact. At BNEF, we're starting to forecast the impact. We think the IRA leads to 10 gigawatts more solar installation every year in the near future, 10 to 15 gigawatts more wind installation per year, and potentially 10 percentage points more EV adoption in the US out to 2030. So we're only going to see more and more acceleration. And the future is incredibly bright, actually. Last year, we saw 350 gigawatts of wind and solar deployed globally. This year, that's going to be 430-odd gigawatts and rising to around 800 gigawatts by the end of this decade. So we're looking at another doubling over the next 7 or so years. So acceleration is one of the themes of our new era. But what are some of the other themes? What's the mood music in some of the other areas of the energy transition? Well, clearly energy security and energy volatility is very much front of mind. This is actually a picture of a compressor station on the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. It's a facility that at this point likely will never be operated in anger. And I think it's an important reminder that energy security is an issue that's going to be here for a long time and it's not going to go away. But volatility is the other part of that equation. You know, we like to think about the transition to net zero as this smooth curve. We always draw smooth curves when we go to 2050 because it's very tempting to think we'll just phase down things. But in fact, transitions are volatile. You know, there are going to be shocks on the supply side. There are going to be shocks on the demand side. And I think it's important for us to remember that. But with that said, even though volatility is here to stay, we think clean energy is going to have the enduring advantage. There was a lot of worry here in Europe over the last year because coal generation went up in the wake of the Russian gas supply crisis. But our team is now saying that actually this year the use of fossil fuels in power generation in Europe is going to fall quite sharply, thanks to demand side management, thanks to the return of nuclear and hydro resources, and of course the growth of wind and solar as well. So we have to make sure that we sort out the short-term noise from the long-term signal. And similarly, if you zoom out and look globally at the costs of energy resources, despite that rise in costs, clean energy continues to enjoy an advantage over fossil fuels. And it's actually widened its advantage during the course of the energy crisis. Even as coal and gas remain elevated, onshore wind, offshore wind, solar have now returned to a cost decline trajectory. And so that advantage just continues to get wider. So when I think about energy security, I actually think about it as a new version of the energy trilemma that I think we all know and love. I think those of us who've been around in the energy transition remember about 10 years ago, we had this energy trilemma. You know, you want your energy to be affordable and secure and sustainable. But back then, the sustainable bit was the hard part. Like you could have the affordable and secure, but if you want it sustainable, it was going to be expensive and it wouldn't be reliable. And I think that paradigm has now flipped. Now, 10 years later, we have a second version of this energy trilemma where you still have the same three pieces that you're aiming for: affordable, secure, and sustainable. But I think the sustainable part is now the no-brainer. It's now the easy part, because the sustainable part is the affordable part, and by the way, helps with energy security as well. So I do think we're in a different era and a different paradigm. A second incredibly important theme for this new era is countries in competition. This picture is from the Tokyo Olympics. I think it's the women's 4x400 meter relay, and there's quite a few countries on here that I think are relevant to the conversation. The US, the UK, Canada, Ukraine is there, Netherlands, Italy. But if we think about the energy transition as a race, as a competition between countries, there's clearly one country glaringly missing from this image, and that is China. Out of that $1.1 trillion last year, China is spending about half of those dollars. So half of that investment in the global energy transition is happening in China today. And that's because of China's very aggressive renewable energy targets, its very strong electric vehicle industry, and the fact that it's starting to decarbonize some of those difficult sectors like steel and doing more on recycling. The United States is in second place, $141 billion. And actually that's going to grow thanks to the Inflation Reduction Act. And then you have kind of European countries and a few other Asian countries. If you take the EU as a block, the EU is 180 billion. So the EU would actually be second place if you took it all together. But this is only the picture when it comes to deployment of technology. There's a whole separate race going on supply chains and manufacturing and capturing the economic value and capturing the industrial sectors of the future. And here, China's not half of the equation. China is 80 to 90% of the solar PV value chain. It's around 70 to 80% of the lithium-ion battery value chain. In metals refining, it depends which metals. It can be up to 50, 60, 70%, and it's about half of the wind supply chain. So there's a whole different race that now has begun. The starting gun has been fired, and there's one country that is currently enjoying an advantage. And when we look at the numbers in terms of the dollars flowing into those facilities, that number is growing quickly. So we tracked $79 billion of investment into manufacturing facilities for solar and batteries and wind and hydrogen and so on. But 90% of those dollars are still flowing in China. So despite the conversations we've been having over the last couple of years of friendshoring and supply chain resilience, we're yet to see that shift really, you know, really materialize. So I think we're looking for, you know, what are the signals that this is really going to change? And we look to the IRA. It's clear that the IRA is going to change the picture. Since the passage of that piece of legislation last year, we've tracked $35 billion of new announcements of companies planning to build facilities in the US around EV and battery manufacturing. And that covers the whole value chain from EV manufacturing to battery manufacturing and recycling and cathode material production and all the rest of it. So we're starting to see that, that needle move. And it's important to remember that the US and China, you know, the US is not the only game in town. China's not the only game in town. India has already had success using competitive auctions to allocate subsidies for solar manufacturing. And it has another tranche of funding being auctioned this year, around 200 billion rupees, to build out the solar value chain locally in India. And that could lead to up to 111 gigawatts of capacity for cells and modules. And of course, here in Europe, we're going to see this response now with the net zero Green Deal industrial plan that's been announced and now is going to work its way through in the next few months. So countries in competition, I think, is going to be one of the overarching frameworks for this new era of transition. And we're all going to have to figure out how to navigate and how to capture the opportunities from that. And then finally, my last theme or the last kind of characteristic, I think, of this era of the transition is the execution imperative. We're now almost a quarter of the way to 2030. We're almost a quarter of the way through this most decisive decade for low carbon transition for climate action. So when we think about those net zero commitments that have now reached 90% of the world's emissions, actually, it feels like the focus is less on how do we get that from 90 to 100, but more on how do we turn that 90% ambition into action? How do we start getting the ball rolling on these projects and scaling it up? And I haven't, it's not by accident that I've chosen a picture of power grids to make this point. Last year, we tracked $270 billion of global investment into power grids, either new build or refurbishment or expansion of power transmission and distribution assets. And that $270 billion, if you add that to the $1.1 trillion that I mentioned earlier, you get this number at the bottom left, the $1.38 trillion invested in the energy transition and grids in 2022. And to get on track for net zero by 2050, according to BNEF's scenario, that number needs to more than triple overnight to about $4.5 trillion per year each year for the rest of this decade, and then go up to $6.8 trillion every year in the next decade and $7.8 trillion every year in the 2040s. So we're moving in the right direction. We're not moving fast enough. And although we use dollars, we use money to track progress because it's the unit, it's the only unit that actually cuts across every sector. So you use dollars to track. But actually, the problem isn't necessarily money. The, you know, capital is available. You know, if you don't believe me, I know some Australian bankers who can help you. It's actually, you know, we need to start de-bottlenecking and removing the barriers to the energy transition. So that's things like permitting and interconnection queues and grid expansion mine investments for critical materials and scaling up hydrogen and developing the business models and the offtake agreements and all of this de-risking that needs to happen to scale everything up. So for me, actually, the dollars are the sign of whether you're doing it right, but the actually doing it right is all of these hard things that are around execution and getting it right. So just to end on, you know, just to kind of summarize everything, I think we have entered a decisive new era for the energy transition, and I think there's really four things. I think we're going to see acceleration and scaling up. There's no turning back. I think this stuff is only going to go faster and faster. I think energy security and energy volatility will be a feature and a priority over the coming years. Countries in competition are absolutely something we're all going to have to learn to navigate. And then finally, this execution imperative, really probably the most important thing that we all need to focus on. Hope that's been useful. Thank you very much for having me.